Yes, welcome everybody. Today is Saturday, the 6th day of June, 6-6-2020. And we are going to, we're at the workshop. We've just finished listening to or working with Professor Rashid Sunny on factor analysis. We're going to move on to cluster analysis. And the first part of it for this workshop is going to be theoretical basis of cluster analysis. And we're going to have, just a minute, we're going to have, as you can see from my screen, we've finished factor analysis. We're going to have Professor Michael Ahove to walk us through cluster analysis. We're with 9 of our course, AC811911, Advanced Educational Research Methods and Statistics, Saturday, June 6. Professor Michael Ahove, you have the floor. Take the floor, Mike.
Thank you very much, sir. I want to share my screen.
Yes, please.
Yeah, thank you very much, sir, for the opportunity. Being a Afrocentric, greeting the Ekarosa in the Yoruba language, I want to.
This is a Yoruba child. Afrocentric, Oyibo child, don't understand Yoruba. This is not Oyibo child. You don't get the African man.
This one is the
albino. Albino.
You can see the nose, African nose. It's all about hybrid in the house.
Yes.
Thank you, sir. I also want to appreciate our Vice Chancellor for national leadership, who is the Grand Superintendent.
Of course, that's it.
Yes, sir.
Let's go on. You know, you don't have much time.
So I'm looking at the theoretical aspect of cluster analysis today, and then we'll look at some of the basic concepts about cluster analysis. So what's the goal of today's lesson? First is for us to be able to define cluster analysis. The second thing is to be able to state the types of cluster analysis. The next is to identify the steps of cluster analysis. And finally, to give you some protocol for the use of cluster analysis in IBM SPSS software.
By the way, David is greeting us in his language there, but carry on. He said his greetings in his local language. Afrocentricism, yeah.
Yes, sir. So let's look at the genesis. In the beginning, two individuals, driver, not conductor really, driver and Cooper in 1932, originated this idea of cluster analysis. But by 1939, two gentlemen, Joseph Zubin in 1938 and Robert in 1939, began to apply what Jiver and his colleague did. And that's how people started using cluster analysis, first in psychology. By 1943, Cattell began to popularize cluster analysis. So it was much more known by so many people in 1943. And that's a challenge, that someone may start an idea, others may popularize it. Just like our potential degree professor is one man who popularized and communicated science globally and essentially strongly within the African computer system. Our potential professor also was the one who also popularized this concept in education in our university and around Nigeria. So what is cluster analysis? Well, cluster analysis is a multivariate technique that classifies sample based on the subject and sets out the measured variables into a number of different groups such that these similar subjects are placed in the same group. So cluster analysis, very simple, simply does categorizes or classifies subjects or situations or variables, measures them, and put them to different groups that we refer to as clusters. That is simply what cluster analysis does. Now, there are some fundamental hints that I want you to understand about cluster analysis. First, it is an exploratory analysis that seeks to identify structures within a data set. It looks into the different structures, different categorization within a set of data. That's what it does. And at the same time, it implies that it segments data and give names to different data based on their set. Another important thing we need to know about cluster analysis is that it identifies homogeneous groups of cases into groupings, which the researcher in the beginning may not have identified. So cluster analysis will pick all those who are homogeneous into a particular groups as cases and group them together based on their commonality. Therefore, you see also that in cluster analysis, you cannot say these are the dependent variable or independent variables, because the dependent variable and independent variable are not practically used in cluster analysis, but basically it's like categorization or classification. Cluster analysis has no mechanism for differentiating between relevant and irrelevant variables, unlike what Professor Sonny has just taught us on factor analysis. Factor analysis will bring out the relevant variables. And as our professor mentioned, irrelevant variables, like the one he mentioned, that has two loadings, minus five somewhere, and then five somewhere, or two different categorization. That it does not apply with the cluster analysis. So there is a similarity. Both of them does classification, but this one does not bring out the one that is relevant and the one that is not relevant. So let's mention some of the basic assumptions why we are using cluster analysis. In cluster analysis, there is normality. We discussed normality severally in this class. There is normality of the sample, that has a normal sample, normal population. Secondly, it has to be homogeneous. Homogeneity is very essential. Very often, randomization is done, and the samples are mutually exclusive. That means you don't find a particular group of characteristics of a group of samples in one place and then find another place. They are always, mutually exclusive. Three types of cluster analysis you will find in SPSS. There are other statistical software that have other forms of cluster analysis. Okay? Up to about four or five, out of about six or seven types of cluster analysis, you find in some others. But in SPSS that we are using for this course, there are three basic types of methods of cluster analysis. The first is the K-means cluster. The K-means cluster. The second is the hierarchical cluster. And the third one is the two-step cluster. The K-means cluster is also known as the non-hierarchical cluster. K-means cluster is also known as the non-hierarchical cluster. It's also described as a quick technique that is very good for large data, very large data. You can use this type of cluster for it. It's also known to have a number of clusters ahead. You define the number of clusters ahead as you analyze them. Before you do the analysis, you have to define the number of clusters, you know, that you want to analyze. There's a particular template in SPSS that will tell you to define the minimum cluster you want and the maximum you're expecting, so that all the variables or the cases kept within that cluster. It's also good for testing different models with different assumed number of clusters. When you have different samples, you want to check the different way they are going to behave within that population. Then K means it's a sure bet. Now, what are the steps for K means? As I said, we are looking at the theoretical part of it. Now, with these steps that I'm giving you, you can on your own practice before we do the second step of how to analyze your cluster analysis. First, we go to analyze, and we have used analyze a lot. The next, you have, as long as you click on analyze, you have a drop down. That drop down should move towards the end, about the third part of the drop down. You will see classify. As soon as you are clicking classify, it will open you the other drop down, and then you will find these other types of cluster analysis. One of the cluster analysis you will find there is the K-means cluster. With the K-means cluster, the next thing you have to do is to select your variables. Just like Sonny told you, you will pick on the variables that you want to examine, then you put them into the box. Put the variables in the box, and then you go to the method, ensure that your iteration is clean. You find classify there, and don't change the variables there because that is the default. The default normally for iterate is usually 10 in your SPSS. So you leave it or allow it to be like that. Okay, so once you have identified your iteration, the next thing, you can go to statistics, click on the statistics, identify the variables you want to analyze the statistics, go to the plot. Identify the variables to again the plots. That's where you see the diagrams. And then the next thing is to click on the save menu. When you click on the save menu, what SPSS will do for you is to identify the cluster membership and distance. The cluster membership and distance, sometimes you find it as the observations you have. You click on it. There are two, you will find the cluster membership and distance. Yeah? You will also find cluster membership only. So you click from cluster membership and distance. And then the next thing you would have to do is just to click on OK. So as you click on OK, it will run the analysis for you. So the practical is best for you to see. The next type of cluster analysis is the hierarchical cluster analysis. As the name implies, it's hierarchical, step by step from the top to the lower level. It's most common type of cluster analysis. It also generates a number of models, the cluster solution, usually from one. But it will not be an intelligent decision because the system will prompt you to tell how many clusters you want, from where do you want to start and where do you want to stop. So if you say you want to start from one, it's as if you don't need clusters because it has to be a minimum of two. So you click on two, then usually maybe a minimum of four or five, a maximum of four or five or six, depending on what you expect from that set of data. You work with the variables. When you talk of cluster analysis here, algorithm. So you find the there are two that are there. So usually proximity is advised to be used when you have a very small amount of sample. That would be the quantity or the number of samples that you are working on. They are not much. Then you are advised to use proximity. Okay. So that will not give you too much challenge because the sample size is really small. Then you have another section there that will look at the range of your cluster. In the range of your clusters, you always advise to use the minimum of two. Then you can go ahead to have maybe five or more. or less than 5. Usually I use 2 to 4 so I can see the clusters properly. You go to the save mode, you find it on the right of your box. You click on the save. What that save is doing is that it's going to keep all the your data for you and leave them under cluster membership. All of them goes under cluster membership. After that, you find under that, above that save, you find plots. You click on plots. When you click on plots, you will find, you will take a decision to usually use the plots. In the plot, it's going to help you run it's going to give a very long bar chart of virtually all the variables that you are running in your sample. So all of them will be released that you will find there. So usually what I tell students and those who are analyzing is that there is a portion there that you can help to reduce the size of the plot, but you can also learn to copy the size of the plot. The third type of analysis, plot analysis, is the two-step cluster. The two-step cluster apparently is actually a combination of the two. But the way the two-step clusters is run is quite simpler. As soon as you go to analyze, you go to the clusters, you find about four clusters. Type of cluster analysis coming up. You just click on two steps. As soon as you click on two steps, you click OK, the computer will just run the two steps. So you actually have about two types of diagrams there. And it will show you first, very good, or poor, with different colors. Usually the poor will be like orange color or brown color. The good will be like yellow. And then the green will be like good. So all what two steps cluster will do for you will immediately analyze for you and show you how all your samples are categorized, how it can be classified into three or more groups. So it identifies the grouping by running a pre-clustering test, and then you can then run your hierarchical data to show the details of your method. And also, you can also have what we call the dendrogram. The dendrogram is the diagram that you normally find two steps does quick cluster algorithm up front for you and handles as well very large data that you have to analyze. I said earlier that it combines the two methods. It also handles scale and ordinal data in the same model and automatically selects the clusters for you. So these are the theoretical steps that you can take as individuals to be able to do your cluster analysis. Thank you very much.
Thank you so very much, Professor Mike Ahove, for the very clear, very well illuminated, well elucidated. You may stop sharing your screen. Well elucidated presentation on cluster analysis. As Professor Michael Ove has said, I mean, it's clustering, to just put people together, cluster them. You are still sharing your screen. Yeah, you may wish to stop sharing. Yeah, okay, no problem at all. Yeah, so as he walks towards or sharing his screen so that we can see ourselves, the floor is now open for us to ask a question or two or make an observation of cluster analysis. See, by the time Professor Michael gets into the practice of it, you'll get to see how you apply it to your research, how you apply it in everyday. Yeah, every day, your research in for your doctoral thesis and elsewhere in your research. So you got to see the application value of cluster analysis, either to the scientists or the like David, like Ramadan, like Bugoma, or to the STEM educator, ICT educator, like some others here. So floor is now open. We have about 10 minutes. We may spend less than that, so you can allow me time to say a few things and then prepare. That's outside the outside this cluster analysis. So I can end the lesson. Yes. Any quick comments for now? I can see all that enjoy. Yes. Who else? All right. For that enjoy, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, sir. Let me start from the when you're telling us about the normality, homogeneity, and random sampling. Is it? I remember I asked that on under factor analysis, and first only answered me that it is not either of the statistics. It's safe to call this a parametric statistics by these assumptions. That is number one, sir. Number two, I want to assume that the under statistics, you said we have the proximity. The second one, I think, is the agglomeration. I don't know if I'm correct. That was the last thing I read about it.
Okay. That's fine. That's fine.
Thank you,
but, Professor Mike, before you answer that, I like you, you know, because you are, you know, very senior citizens in this business. So let me explain to you again. I think I explained in one of my Statistics Made Easy videos. And please listen very carefully to this matter of the assumptions. Let's take Fred Auer conducting a study in Presbyterian High School in Ghana. Okay? He wants to be able to generalize beyond Presbyterian High School. He wants to be able to extrapolate, that is, extrapolate means extend his findings beyond Presbyterian to some others. So, Bugoma, for instance, doing some work in Burundi, maybe working on 10 communities, I want to say, oh, this can apply to all communities in the whole of Africa. All right. So, the goal is from your sample to be able to extrapolate or generalize your findings to the larger population, you must meet some conditions. So those are the parametric assumptions. Parameters are parameters, you know, relating to statistics, related to sample, relative to the population. So any statistic, let's take factor analysis. You are not generalizing to anything. That's what Professor Sonia said. You are just doing it there. Cluster analysis, you collect your sample. I want to generalize any statistic that you use that will enable you test your sample to be able to generalize. So don't ask that question again, frequently, because it's obvious that any statistic that indicates that you must meet some parametric assumptions means that it is one that you have to you have to apply when you want to generalize. Is that clear? Very clear. Statistics,
very clear,
any statistic that has not got any parameter as well means that nothing concerns you with anything. You are just doing it inside your house. Nothing. Finish. But if you have to go outside your house to now say, oh, Kule, where are you located at the moment? Where are you?
Lusada.
Lusada. Okay, you're not far from me. I'm in Agbara. That okay, your house in Lusada, it's going to apply to me in my house here in Agbara. Aha. Then you have to meet some assumptions. So that's it, yeah. So it's different. Factor analysis, you are just analyzing the thing and put it in your pocket. But if you want to now put it in my own pocket, then you have to meet those assumptions. So what Professor Ahove is saying is that now cluster analysis, in fact, if that question didn't arise, it means that cluster analysis is a parametric test for you to be able to extend beyond your sample. All right.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you very much. Fred Auer, are you clear with that? Can you unmute yourself?
Yes, sir.
What are you clear about?
That you can use it to extrapolate, meaning that you can use it to extend beyond your local research area. For instance, you gave an example that if I'm doing research at the Presbyterian secondary school, and I want to extend the findings to a larger, maybe the whole of Ghana or
Nigeria. But factor analysis, you don't have to do it. I'm just doing it for the Professor Sonia said, we're getting some skills from that instrument. We're not using it. We have not tested it. We have not used that instrument. Let me even tell you what I did in my doctoral work, as I mentioned, you know, to you earlier. I developed my own instrument myself, and that's what I'm asking people to do. Develop your own instrument. Conduct this factor analysis on it to be able to validate those scales. And you see, it doesn't even tell you, like I did in my own work, that, okay, now you have an instrument that you've conducted all of these things in. It doesn't stop there. I had to then go, after I found out the factorial validity of the instrument, I then had to go again to the field to test its other reliabilities, including Cronberg, Sapphire, including test, retest. Anyway, that's what this person has mentioned to you. So, Michael, you have the floor.
Yes, thank you, sir. Thank you for the question. And as Prof said, these are the answer to the question. The cluster requires you that meet those assumptions. When you meet those assumptions, technically, you are having in your hand parametric tool for analysis.
Sure.
So if those assumptions are not there, it becomes a free for all. You can just do as you wish. But when you do as you wish, you cannot say everybody's involved, because it's like you're on your own. But if you follow parametric statistics, then you can begin to generalize and say, yes, it extends to people with similar characteristics.
Exactly. Thank you so very much. We have to bring this session to a close. And we have to give a round of applause to our Professor Mike Ahove, who will, in another class, you know, walk us through the practice of this thing and be able to see how important cluster analysis is. As I've often encouraged you, if you don't use the analysis in your doctoral work, you may not be stimulated to use the analysis again. So my suggestion, is find a role for it in your work, somehow, so that you will have practice using it. The PhD is a training platform. After your PhD, you can then be able to, you know, use or not use it. But it's important for you if you're able to get this thing in. So on that note, I want to bring this lesson to a close and to wish you a very nice weekend.